Good morning, good morning. How's everyone doing out there? Woo! I like it, I like it. I'm excited to see everyone here today, all your beautiful smiles. We are all gathered here today to move from surviving to thriving. Here at Victory Anaheim, we believe that every one of us can live a victorious Christian life. Amen. We want that for you. We want to help you have an awesome church experience here at Victory. In order to do that, we created this program called a response form. This program will help you stay involved, get involved, and continue your faith with Christ. Make sure to put your contact information on the response form, and you're going to turn it in at the resource table located at the very back. For newcomers, we have a gift for you. We have a Victory Coffee Tumbler. It's going to be at the resource table as well. When you complete your response form, you're going to turn it in and make sure you grab yourself one on the way out. Today, I have some announcements for you. The first announcement is going to be about fellowship groups. Fellowship groups have started back up. The fellowship groups that are in session right now are the Spark, Kids, and Men's Ministry. Joining one of these groups is a great way to get connected, make new friends, and to build your faith. If you are interested in joining any of these groups, please let us know on your response form. For the next announcement, we have our Easter extravaganza coming up on April 1st, Saturday at Maxwell Park. Woo! This is a great opportunity we have as a church to reach out to the community who may or may not know Jesus. By doing so, make sure to invite your friends, family, and neighbors to this awesome event leading up to Easter. There will be games, face painting, food trucks, and of course, a huge egg hunt. We are going to need lots of help in all areas. If anyone is interested in helping us out, please let us know on the response form or talk to us, and more information will be provided at the resource table. For the last announcement, Easter Sunday is happening on April 9th, 10:30 a.m. here at Victory Anaheim. Let's go! Woo! Right after service, we're going to be having Easter festivities and an egg hunt for all the kids. If you're thinking about inviting someone, pray for that someone before you invite them. Invite them to be your guests and to remind them the day before Easter. And when you go about inviting people, we have Victory Anaheim Easter Sunday invite cards. There's going to be a stack at the resource table. Make sure to grab a few on your way out. And I'm going to give it to the worship team.
Thank you, Roger. Rise and shine, and let's give God some glory. Give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things.
rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Sing it again. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. Yeah, yeah. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Well, good morning, Victory. We got to celebrate with the Taganods yesterday.
Woo!
Peter and Gabby got married.
Let's go!
It's always so wonderful to celebrate the good things in life. And I know sometimes we may be in seasons where it gets a little hard to celebrate. But there's something that you need to remember. Even though things may not go at our timing, maybe things aren't going as we plan or as we want or as we see fit, we have to remember God's character. He is good. He is faithful. He is sovereign. And I'm not sure what you guys are going through, if you're having health issues, financial issues, making big decisions, you're in a place where you feel dry. Well, Jesus promised to give us everlasting water. And Pastor is going through Peter, 1 Peter. And I wanted to share a scripture with you that, you know, spoke to me. And see if my phone will work with me here. Thank you for your patience. I didn't memorize it. 1 Peter 22 through 24. You were cleansed from your sins when you obeyed the truth, so now you must show sincere love to each other. As brothers and sisters, love each other deeply with all your heart. For you have been born again, but not to a life that quickly ends. Your new life will last forever because it comes from the eternal living word of God. As scriptures say, people are like grass. Their beauty is like the flower in the field. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord remains forever. We can know that there's lots of things in life that change. Fashion, cool words to say. There's lots of things that can seem to be hip or in. But then, you know, yesterday's fashion is gone and yesterday's lingo is replaced, but the word of God never fails. And, you know, I was thinking about that. Like, if I had something to remember and depend on, like, say, this paper, what's going to happen if I let it go? It's going to drop, right? What's going to happen if I let it go now? Tell me. It's going to drop. Right? God made some laws of the universe. That's going to happen. Remember, time and time again, God is faithful. He will not forsake his people. He is sovereign, and you can trust in the Lord. Father, we come to you now with open hands and open hearts and open minds, open ears to hear what you would have us hear, open eyes to see what you would have us see. Holy Spirit, we ask you to be full in our lives. May we make room for your working and for your moving, and remember every day that you are faithful. Let's sing to the Lord. You were reaching through the storm. You were reaching through the storm. Walking on the water, even when I could not see. In the middle of it all, when I thought you were 1,000 miles away, not for a moment did you forsake me, not for a moment did you forsake me. And after all, you are constant. And after all, you are only good. And after all, you are sovereign. Not for a moment did you forsake. You.
sovereign, not for a moment will you forsake me, not for a moment will you forsake me, not for a moment will you forsake me.
Trust him. He's Amen. Faithful.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
It's good to be together. Glad we're able to be here. You know, as we get started, I just want to go before the Lord and pray for some folks in our church who are ill. And I'd ask you to join me right now. Will you pray with me? Our God and our Father, there are times in our lives when illness comes into our lives. A great illness is never welcome. It's hard to go through. It tests our faith. It tests our sanity. And Lord, there are some in our church family that aren't doing well right now. And Lord, we ask for your grace on their lives. We ask for your hand on their lives. Some of their family members are right here in this service, God. I just pray, God, that you be with each one of those who are some in the hospital right now. I know of three people in our church that are very, very ill right now. And God, I pray for your grace on their lives, for your goodness to be with them. I pray that you would sustain their lives, their hearts, their attitude, their faith. I pray that you be with their family members, that they would be able to also sustain their faith and be an encouragement. I pray that you be with doctors. Lord, help those doctors to do the very best that they've ever done to give care to those who are ill. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. We are in the midst of a sermon series on the book of 1 Peter, like Marcia was talking about. And 1 Peter is a short book, but it's filled with a lot of wisdom, and it's got this theme that goes throughout the book. It's about that Christians are a different kind of people. Christians aren't like everyone else. We see the same problems, the same difficulties, the same situation, but we see it with different eyes because we have different eyes and we are different people. And I want to begin by telling you, when I was a little boy, I was a very selfish boy. I was super selfish. Sometimes I think about how I was as a little boy and the heartache I caused on my mom, and I think, man, I needed to be healed badly. And when I say a child needs to be healed, sometimes I'm out and about in public and I see the way some children act and I go, oh, I remember me like that. And I think, I needed to be healed and that child needs to be healed. Needs their parents to lay hands on them to heal them. And I was selfish, I was entitled, and I was mean. I thought that my mom's sole purpose in life was to make me happy. But as I matured, I realized that happiness is a choice. I realized that love is a choice. And I realized that responsibility is a choice. Thank God for maturity that comes with age. The seasoning of our lives and our perspective that comes only with age. And I want to begin this series, or this message, excuse me. It's called Pure-Hearted Love. This message is called Pure-Hearted Love. And it's a vision for a different kind of life. It's a different for a Christian life. It's a vision for a Christian life. What I like to call the victorious Christian life. The beginning of this kind of life is an awakening to Jesus, an awakening to God, an awakening to what God wants to do in your life, and the kind of life that God has for you, and the kind of life that God is inviting you into. It's, in its purest form, it starts with God's love. And so I want to begin with in chapter 1 of 1 Peter, if you want to follow along with me. Today's text is 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 22 through chapter 2 and verse 3. It's about five verses that we're going to go over right now. And I want to begin with verse 22. I'm going to read verse 22. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Christians are different because, starting with that, our souls are purified. Our souls are purified. And secondly, we obey the truth. Christians are different from people in the world, from people who do not know Christ, from people who are not Christians, because our souls have been purified and because we obey the truth of God, is what Peter is telling us here. I want to ask a question. What is it like if Christians have purified souls? What's the opposite of a purified soul? A dirty soul. A filthy soul. So what's it like to have a filthy soul? Remember your life before Christ. Remember who you used to be before you met Jesus. Think about this. The Bible makes this contrast between a purified soul and a filthy soul, so that we might remember. This is here right now so that we might remember where we came from. And it's important for Christians to remember. It's very important for us to remember, because when we remember who we were, we can exercise grace on those who are like we were. Because there are people today who are like what you used to be like before Christ. And if you had the blessing of being raised by a Christian family and raised being part of a church family, it really is a blessing. It's a blessing that you can take for granted. And maybe you go, well, I don't have stories of a life that was before Christ that was filled with sin and evil. Maybe you don't. But somehow you need to be able to know what that life is like. And maybe you have a different kind of problem, that you see the world through judgmentalism, through a lens that where you judge people who don't have purified souls. And we need to have a different posture than that in order to follow God, in order to be victorious Christians as God would have us to be. And as Peter talks about here in this passage. So Peter makes this distinction between those who have purified souls and those who don't have purified souls. And we need to remember this, that this difference, it's kind of like cleaning a very dirty house or an unkept house. Think about the house. You go into the kitchen and the dishes are piled up high. And they have food all over them, and you're going to like put them in the dishwasher and like, oh, we got to get the food off before we even put them in the dishwasher. And you look in the refrigerator and it's got all, it's filled and it's got these Tupperware things and that have, some of them have been in there too long. And you're like, you open the refrigerator and you go, what smells in here? Something smells disgusting in this refrigerator. You open it up and you start opening things and you're like, no, that's not too old. That's okay. No, that one's okay. And you're like moving things around, pulling things out. And you're like, yeah, that one's starting to go bad. I'm going to get rid of this. And then you pull the one out and you're like, holy moly, this smells rancid. This is disgusting. And you go, I found the culprit. And you throw it out. But maybe you just go, you know what? I'm throwing everything out to have a fresh start. You know, there's times that you do that too. You go into the rooms and you see laundry piled high. Laundry piled high that has been neglected for quite a while. And you go, man, it's a good thing I have a lot of clothes because I can't believe that it seems like a whole wardrobe or two right here piled up. Anybody have that problem? Anybody ever have that problem? You go into the bathroom. You had too many guys who didn't lift the toilet seat. It smells like urine. It's gross and disgusting. Gross. It's a filthy house. But when you clean the house, you feel good about walking into that house. It's like we associate the smell of bleach with clean. You're like, oh, bleach in the bathroom? Yeah, that's good. That's good. It smells clean. I feel like I walked into clean. But after you cleaned it, you need to go take a shower yourself, get cleaned up. Well, this kind of distinction that Peter brings up is like that. Filthy souls apart from God. They're dirty. And the filthier a soul, the more selfish they are. The more self-centered they are. The more mean they are. And the more evil they do. So Peter wants us to remember what a filthy soul was like, so that we might know and be thankful for purified souls. And we might see ourselves not as better than anyone else, but as ones who are purified and be thankful for our purity, the purity of our souls. And so Peter calls on Christians with purified souls to love one another. To love one another based on what? Their conversion. Because we share Christ. We share Christ after we come to faith in Christ. We share that we have Christ in common. Brothers and sisters, believers, that we love one another with brotherly love. Peter's calling us to share that faith, our common faith, with the people next to us. Look around you. Take a minute. Take your eyes off me and look around. See these people behind you and around you who are brothers and sisters in Christ. We share Christ in common. We are now part of God's family. And so love your brothers and sisters with the love of Christ. That earnest love from a purified heart. And Christians are like family. Christians are family. And we're kind of like your actual family in many ways. You know, your actual family. Your actual brothers and sisters and mom and dad and grandparents and uncles and aunts. Your actual family. We could find parallels to your family in this room right now. Whether you get along with your family or not, you're still family, right? It doesn't matter whether you have the same interests as your family or not, you're still family. Family finds a way to come together, to support each other, to help each other, Because we are family. No matter what, we're always going to be family. And Christian family is the church. The Christian family is the church. Some of us are smart and successful, and some of us are not. Some of us are weird and awkward, but we're brothers and sisters in Christ. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? Well, say to someone, I'm glad we're family. Going on in verse 23, Peter says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding Word of God. Believers are born again. We have a renewal of life. We have a new lease on life. In the scriptures, it's called the old life, who we were before Christ, and the new life, who we are in Christ. Believers are born again through the living and abiding Word. The old life is kind of like milk that you buy in the grocery store. It's good, you use it, and it nourishes your body. But there's a little date stamped on the top of it, right? There's a little date. And you can stretch that date a little bit. You're like, okay, the 17th, today's the 18th. I'll still drink it. It's still good. And then as the days keep going on, if you still have that milk in there, something begins to happen. That's not good. It expires and it's starting to rot. And there's this mold that develops on the inside. I get it. This is my gross day, gross food day. Have you ever accidentally taken a drink of that milk? Have you ever poured that milk in your cereal? And then you take a bite of your cereal and you're like, something's wrong right now. Something's very, very wrong. It's curdled, and then you look at the thing that you didn't see, and you're like, there's green stuff floating around in there. Oh my God, help me. I just drank that stuff. Blah. Yuck. The new life, though, the new life of believers is not like the old life, which will end and die. The new life won't die out. It won't cease to exist. It won't expire. Thank God. It won't grow mold. It won't be disgusting. The new life stays new. So it's not perishable. It's imperishable. This living Word that we have, that we receive. The Word of God, Peter is calling us as Christians, based on what we've received, how we've been transformed to receive the Word of God and to see the Word of God as an important part of our life. He goes on, verse 24, for all flesh is like grass and all its glory like the flowers of the grass. The grass withers, the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you. This word is the good news that was preached to you. It's interesting. Sometimes you have in the scriptures that the writer of the scriptures may reference another part of the scriptures. So when Peter wrote this letter, the book of 1 Peter, he had been reading the book of Psalms. The whole book is called the book of Psalms. If you're referring to one of them, it's a psalm, singular. So Peter was quoting here from Psalm 40, verses 6 and verse 8. In contrasting the weakness of the old life and the power of the word of the Lord, Peter referred to Psalm 40. Our new life came because we heard and received the word of the Lord. You are not spiritually dead, but you are spiritually alive because you heard and received the word of the Lord. At some point in your life, through some means, you heard and received the word of the Lord. Can you remember those days? Can you remember coming alive to the word of the Lord, that your eyes were opened and you could see and appreciate the word of the Lord? Well, the Bible is kind of like important health discoveries. There are physical discoveries or discoveries that we find for best practices to keep ourselves healthy. People used to think that smoking cigarettes was glamorous, correct? Because it was portrayed as glamorous by who? Oh, cigarette companies in their advertisements. What a genius way to make everybody think that smoking is glamorous. Put beautiful people with a cigarette in their hands. Have commercials. Remember, people used to hold their cigarettes like that in the 50s, and you see those. Remember, people used to smoke on television, and you'd see them smoking on television, and it was so glamorous. I Love Lucy used to smoke on the black and whites. Remember that? So people used to smoke because they thought it was glamorous and they thought it was cool, right? James Dean was the image of coolness with him and his cigarette, right? I grew up on heavy metal music and rock and roll, and I started playing guitar. My inspiration to play guitar was Edward Van Halen, and one of the greatest rock and roll guitar players of all time, maybe the greatest. And Eddie Van Halen, he used to take his cigarette, he'd take a puff of his cigarette, he'd be in concert, thousands of people in the concert, put his cigarette between the strings on the neck of his guitar, and then jam all over his guitar, play Eruption all over it. Every like 15-year-old kid like me who watched Eddie Van Halen do that, guess what we wanted to do? Play guitar, smoke cigarettes. I was that 15-year-old kid. I can remember the first time I smoked a cigarette. I can remember, like, all my friends smoked cigarettes. They have their cigarettes on. Let me try a cigarette. And I remember going, no thanks. Like, you have to try it a few times to get used to it. I don't want to get used to it. Let Eddie Van Halen smoke cigarettes. You guys smoke cigarettes. I'm done. That was it with cigarettes for me. I did a lot of bad things in my life, but for cigarettes, all I took was that one time and I was done. Well, we found out over time that smoking cigarettes is really bad for the human body. It's terrible for the human body. It kills people. Literally, with every puff of a cigarette, you're taking a breath of your own life away. Oh my goodness. If we knew that when we started, maybe there's plenty of people who died prematurely that wouldn't have smoked had they known how bad it was. But there's plenty of people who smoke today, even knowing how bad it is, but they still keep smoking. Guys, I gave you that picture because the Bible is like that. People are doing things and living their lives, doing all kinds of things that they don't know is destructive for them. But the Bible is filled with the wisdom to let them know to stop doing those things that are destructive to their relationship, to their body, to their mental health, their physical health, their emotional health, and their spiritual health. People are doing all kinds of things, but the Word of God is the source of health. It gives us a glimpse into the best practices to be healthy in all of these ways. If we'll receive it, if we'll hear it and receive it into our lives and begin to practice it. That's why the Word of God is so, so, so powerful. Can I get an amen? How about those online people? What's your amen? You give me a bunch of like those little hearts right now? Those little online, the online people, are you listening? Online people, look, I've got it live right here. I can see where are the hearts. I'm looking for the hearts, online people. So there are other people in our lives who need to hear the Word of God like you heard the Word of God and like you received the Word of God. There's so many people that you're connected to that need to hear what you heard and need to come alive to what you came alive to by God's grace. How would people know the harm that is coming to them unless someone told them? People had to find out that cigarettes are bad for their health. People have to find out that drinking a lot of alcohol is bad for their health. People have to find out that they're destroying their lives. Who's going to tell them? I know you like doing what you're doing, but I love you too much. I just got to tell you. I got to tell you. There's some good news that you need to know about. And it's found in this thing that we call the Bible. Moving on to chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Peter writes, "So, knowing that you've been transformed by the Word of God, so, knowing that you have new life because you put away the old life, because you became aware of the goodness of God, so, being the people who love one another, embrace one another as family, so, put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk that is, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good." Peter gives five destructive behaviors that every Christian needs to put away. Malice is the intention or desire to do evil. The intention or desire to do evil. Evil in its purest form is selfishness. Selfishness. You can reduce evil to its common denominator is it begins with selfishness. Whatever selfish act that you have, that you do, selfish perspective that you put out there, that selfish perspective leads to evil. So, to live the victorious Christian life, put away malice, any intention or desire to do evil. When the desire to do evil comes up in you, when you're tempted to do something evil, something selfish, how do you curb that act? How do you stop it from happening? You have to think differently. You have to like start quoting scripture. You don't know scripture, start memorizing scripture. Today's your time to start memorizing scripture. You do a Google search. What is the biggest temptation that you struggle with? Scripture's about lying. Scripture's about lust. Scripture's about, you can find scriptures about almost any topic you can envision. Start memorizing those scriptures. Write them on a little card. Put them on your mirror, on your dashboard of your car. Carry them with you. And read that scripture over and over again. The more you read it, the more you quote it, you're going to memorize it. Malice, then deceit. Deceit is deceiving or canceling deceiving or misrepresenting the truth. Misrepresenting the truth is deceit. If you misrepresent the truth, that's deceiving someone. You know what? Every person in the world deceives. They use deceit to protect themselves. When you're caught, as a little child, they don't even have to learn how to do this. When the little child is caught, what did you do? I didn't do anything. They made me. It was her fault, his fault, their fault. Goes right back to the Garden of Eden. When Adam sinned and Eve sinned, and God said, Adam, why did you eat the fruit that I told you not to eat of? His next words out of his mouth, God, it was the woman that you gave to me. She did it first and she brought it to me. God goes to Eve, Eve, why'd you do it? The serpent. We're always passing the buck. We're deceiving. Instead of taking personal responsibility, we deceive by misrepresenting the truth. It's easier to blame someone else, point the finger at someone else. Peter says, put aside malice, put aside deceit, put aside hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is pretending to have a virtuous character that you don't really possess. Pretending to have a virtuous character that you don't really possess. Pretending to be good. It was Brennan Manning in his book, The Ragamuffin Gospel. He said, when I read this quote, I never forgot it. Brennan Manning said, the great temptation of our age is to look good without being good. Every one of us is tempted to look good without truly being good. And there are moments when we take our eyes off of Jesus and we are no longer good in that moment. But it's like Peter. When Peter was on that boat in the storm and Peter came walking on the water and Peter said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come out to you and I'll walk on water too. Jesus said, come, Peter. And Peter was walking on water. Could you imagine that? Actually walking on water? Amazing. In that moment, I don't know if God changed the water so that it was solid for Peter to walk on, or if he changed Peter's feet or Peter's sandals so that they would float on the water no matter what. But Jesus changed the physical world. He bent the physical world to his will. That's the God who we serve. God bends the will of water. Jesus bends the will of water. That's why we have faith, because we believe in what Jesus can do. We believe that Jesus can heal. We believe that Jesus can overcome our circumstances, our bad circumstances. Marcia, we had quite a week, and God overcame some circumstances, didn't he? I'll tell you more about that later, another time. But we believe because Jesus has the power to bend the will of the universe to his will. And Peter says, put away malice, put away deceit, put away hypocrisy. And he says, put away envy. That is feeling discontent or coveting with regard to another person's advantages, success, or possessions. We see what advantage they have, and we feel this discontent about what we don't have. We see their success, and we covet that kind of success for ourselves. We see their possessions, their car, their home, their clothes, their jewelry. We see their possessions, and then we're discontent with what we have, and we want what they have. Peter says, put aside malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. Slander is defamation. False and malicious statements to injure the reputation of someone else. Happens all the time. Happens in the workplace, happens at school, even happens in the church. It's sad. It's ugly. Slander. Peter says, put all of these things away, these destructive behaviors. You are Christians. You're believers in Jesus. Put away that kind of garbage. Put away that kind of destructive behavior. It does not lead to a good life. It does not lead to inner peace, nor does it lead to life filled with love. It's quite the opposite. It's kind of like this. Imagine not exercising in your life at all. Not getting enough physical activity. Imagine eating terrible food for you all the time, regularly. Imagine that night after night, you're not getting enough sleep. Even if you're 50, 60 years old, it's still recommended that you get eight hours of sleep. You're like, I can't sleep. I don't know. I notice that when I have better habits for sleeping, I sleep better. You know, like looking at this, like right before you go to bed, it's actually going to keep you awake. The blue light is like, it's doing something in your mind. And I notice when I do that, I don't sleep well. But if I take a little bit of time and like put it aside and like, okay, I'm done looking at my phone now. I'm done looking at whatever. I sleep better and I don't wake up. Just that little thing. I notice when I make routines for myself, okay, brush my teeth before bed. Okay, start gearing. If I eat right before bed, I promise you, I'm going to have a hard time going to bed. And I do that too often. I've noticed. I've done the practice the last few weeks. I've been trying to work on my sleeping habits. And I noticed when I eat at 9 o'clock at night, I'm going to have a hard time falling asleep at 11 o'clock at night. But if I eat earlier, I can fall asleep easier. Well, okay, imagine having all these bad habits. You don't get enough movement in your life. You're eating really badly. You're not sleeping well. And then you go, why am I so unhealthy? What's wrong? I don't understand why I'm not very healthy. I don't get it. I just don't understand. Well, destructive behavior leads to an unhealthy life. That's just reality. So Peter's saying malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander. If any of these shows up in your life, you're not going to have a healthy life. So suppress them. Replace them with God's goodness. Instead of destructive behavior, Christians are different. The word calls us to be different. Like newborn infants, Peter says, long for spiritual milk, pure spiritual milk, Peter says. There's another scripture that Paul talks about milk with the word, and this isn't that. Peter's using it differently. When Paul talked about it, he's like calling Christians, he's going like, you received the milk of the word, but I'm trying to give you the meat, and you're like infants. You're not mature enough to handle the meat, Paul said. This isn't that. This is different. Peter is saying right here, he's going, be like a newborn infant. God blessed us, my family, with a newborn infant in our lives. Our son David and his wife Chloe had little David the fourth 3 months ago. And sometimes we're all obsessed with this little boy. You guys know what that's like if you have your grandparents. We're obsessed with this little boy. Every time he's around us, somebody's got a camera out and like just filming him just sitting there doing nothing or like eating or sleeping or laughing. You're like, nobody wants to record, you know, when you're older, nobody wants to record you laughing. When you're older, nobody wants to record you sleeping. When you're old, they only want to do it to make fun of you. Sometimes if I'm snoring too loud, my wife will pull out her camera and she'll take me. She's like, I just want to show you how loud you are when you... In the family group chat, then everybody got that video. That's the only reason why they record me now. But that little baby, little David, when he's fussy, and then Chloe will go, oh, it's time for him to eat, and then she'll bring his bottle out, and that kid instantly stops. And he's like, that bottle is like the best thing in the world. You can just see it, how he's just like, you're sucking that milk down and just drinking it and just so satisfied, so longing for it. He was fussy because he wanted that milk. He was longing for it. He was crying for it. He was fussing about it. And everybody's going to know that he's fussy until he gets that milk. Sometimes you try to pacify him and sometimes it works, but it's no substitute for the milk. When he wants that milk and he's like craving for that milk and when he gets that milk, it's like, everybody was looking at it like, oh, look at him eat his milk. Oh, he loves his milk. Oh, we love it. Peter is saying, be like that with the Word of God. You be like that. Don't start crying and fussing. It doesn't become you. But long for it like that. Long for the Word in your life. Every single day you need the Word of God in your life. You know, the navigators came up with this thing, and I've shared it before, and they're like, take your hand, look at your hand like this. Look at those five fingers, and do it with me right now. Look at your five fingers. The navigators is an organization that helps people get into the Word, study the Word, and they came up with these five things that you can do with the Word of God. Write this down. If you got something to write it down or on your phone, take notes, write this down. There are five things that you can do with the scriptures. Here are the five things, and I'm going to give you one scripture that you can look up on your own later on. First, hear the word, Romans 10:17. Second, read the word, Revelation 1:3. Third, study the word, Acts 17:11. Fourth, memorize the word, Psalm 119:9-11. Fifth, meditate on the word of God, Psalm 1:2-3. Hear the word, read the word, study the word, memorize the word, meditate on the word. Regularly, weekly, daily, put these practices into your life with the word of God so that you come into spiritual maturity. You don't want to be so long in as a Christian and still be immature in the faith. There are phases to Christian maturity. And those phases, we call it overarching the whole thing, the journey, we call it discipleship, right? From the Bible, we take this imagery that they're the first phase. Phase one is spiritually dead. Those are the ones that their souls are filthy. They're spiritually dead. But then something happens and they walk across the line of faith and they become an infant Christian. An infant Christian who could only handle the word as the milk and not handle it as meat yet. But they start off as an infant and then they become a child in the faith as they grow up in the faith and they become less self-centered. And then they become a young adult in the faith and then a spiritual parent in the faith. And that's a cycle, these phases of the spiritual life. And so we're meant to keep growing in the faith. And Peter, I just want to point out, in that scripture, he on verse 3, he said, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. So be like infants who long for the milk and are satisfied with the milk. This spiritual milk nourishes the soul, and it is the word of God in your life. Christians will continue to long for the word if they have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. Has the Lord been good to you? Has God been good to you? Can you think of one time in the last week where God's been good to you? Think about that. And you go, okay, in spite of these terrible things, here's where God's been good to me. You've tasted and seen that the Lord is good. And that keeps you going, keeps you coming back, because you want to taste the Lord's goodness over and over again. It's like tasting new food you've never tried before. Remember I told you when I was a little boy, I was bad. When it came to food, I was the pickiest child. I've never seen a child as picky as I was when I was a little boy. I see some hands going up back there. But I was very, very picky as a little boy. And so I came to a point where, like, oh, you talk about milk? My lips will never touch milk. I did not like milk. They say it was because of this. Check this out. I think this is where it started. I was 3 years old and still drinking a bottle. There was a day when my mom said, you're too old to drink milk from a bottle, so I'm not giving you a bottle anymore. And I said, no, I want a bottle. I want to drink my milk from a bottle, from a little three-year-old perspective. And so that happened, real thing, and then my older sisters, nobody would let me drink that bottle. Much as I wanted a bottle, not getting a bottle. And then I said, I'm never drinking milk again. I don't even remember that happening, but I grew up despising milk. To this day, I cannot just take a glass of milk and just drink it. It makes me want to throw up. I'm not kidding. It literally makes me want to throw up. The only way I'll drink a milkshake. I'll eat milk in my cereal. I'll put milk in my coffee, but I won't drink milk by itself. It's disgusting to me. It's like, I know it's in here. I know it. It's in there. I'm like, okay, I got to get over that. Sometimes I do. I've done it before where I'm just like, okay, I can drink milk. Okay, cheese was another thing. And so I would not touch cheese to these lips. And one day, I was spending the night at my cousin's house, my aunt and uncle. And my aunt Jean, who was married to my uncle Raul, she was a boss lady. And she brought into the marriage a bunch of kids. So they had a full house, big house, all kinds of kids. And there was no room for, like, Aunt Jean did not baby any of her kids. She's like, you don't like what we're eating? Then you're not eating, kid. That's it. I was there. I remember the Friday night. It was time for dinner. They brought in a bunch of pizzas. We're eating pizza. And I'm like, I don't like pizza. What do you mean you don't like pizza? I don't eat pizza. I don't eat cheese. Talking to Aunt Jean. You know, in my house, you go to mom. Mom's the one who's like, hey, mom, I don't like that food. I'm like, oh, yeah, here, let me do something else for you. Let me take the cheese off the pizza for you. Aunt Jean says, what? You don't like pizza? What's wrong with you? And I said, I just don't like cheese. She's like, David, that's what we're having for dinner tonight. So you know what? If you want to eat, David, you better eat this pizza. I'm like, I was kind of afraid of Aunt Jean. So I said, okay. And I took a piece of pizza. It was happened to be pepperoni pizza, and I took a bite of it, and I'm like, and my cousins, they knew that I didn't like cheese, and they're all like with me, watching me eat that pizza, and I take a bite of that pepperoni pizza, and I was like, where have you been all my life? Parents, do what Gene did for me to all your kids who are picky with their food. That's how you parent kids. That's how you have kids who aren't picky. I became a lot less picky that day. Still had some things to overcome. If you put a glass of milk, I came to a place where there's all kinds of food that I don't like. I've been in plenty of places where people put food in front of my plate or on my plate that I don't like, but I eat every bite of it because just suck it up, kid. That's what we're eating. I learned that lesson from Aunt Jean that day. So, Peter says, if you've tasted that the Lord is good, you'll keep coming back to the Word of God. Every day. So people of God, go to the Word of God every day. Let it be part of your lives. The Christian life is this process where there are stages and you grow in the faith. And so I want to call you to keep growing in the faith, to keep maturing in the faith. And I want to call you to remember that there are people who are spiritually dead and that are where you used to be, and you're the link to help them find faith. So take your role seriously and be the person who helps them find faith in Jesus. The Lord is good. Amen. Will you join me in prayer? Our God and our Father, we love you and we praise you and we thank you for this day where we can come together and celebrate your goodness and celebrate that we have the Word of God and that the Word of God in our lives means something. It becomes something. It awakens our souls. It cleanses our souls. And I thank you, Lord, that our souls become clean and we become people who are captivated with pure hearts by the Word of God, and we love one another because we are your people. Because we follow you. I pray, God, that you would help us to live in such ways on this day. May the Word of God fill our souls, purify our souls. And Lord, may we be captivated by your Word each and every day and be people who share your Word, because there's a world out there that needs you. And there might be somebody in the hearing of this message that has never walked across the line of faith to put their trust in Jesus. And I just want to give you that opportunity. It's a choice. It's a decision to say, I'm going to trust God. I'm going to believe in God. And I'm going to go with God. I believe that the Lord is real and that he's calling me into my life right now. He's speaking into my life right now. And if that's you, whether you're watching this on the line, in person, watching a replay of this, you can put your faith and trust in Jesus by letting him know, Jesus, I want you in my life. Jesus, I need you in my life. Jesus, will you come and be the Lord of my life right now? Amen. Will you stand with us as we sing?
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord, we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, and I pray that our unity will one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand, we will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand, and together we'll spread the news that God is in our land, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Whoa, they'll know us by our love. Our love, our love, our love. They'll know us by our love. Our love, our love, our love. nations by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Whoa, whoa. They'll know us by our love.
What a great song. Thank you, worship team. Sounds great. It's like the Lantos plus Lily on the worship team. Very cool. Lily, you're like an adopted member of the Lantos for this moment. Don't worry, Jim and Ellen, we're not stealing them. <don't we? laughs> The Lord is good. We want to take a few moments just to take our offering and the beauty of offering is it's an opportunity, it's a privilege to give back to God. And it's a sign of spiritual maturity when we do so. In our church, we practice the tithe. I encourage you to start giving if you haven't taken that step in your life yet. Begin giving back to God. Begin trusting the Lord with your finances on a regular basis. As often as you get paid, so give back to God. We practice the tithe in our church, and you can give in a couple of ways. You can give in person. The giving box is in the back of the room. You can also use our secure platform at victoryanaheim.org/donate on our website. And I also want to say that Roger talked about this. We have these nifty Easter invite cards. Grab a stack and hold them with you. Take them with you and find somebody that you're going to invite to church. Like Roger was telling you, pray for them first and then invite them. These are for Easter specifically. You can invite someone to church anytime you want, but specifically, people are more open to coming to church for Easter. So I just want to invite you, grab a stack of these and invite people to come to church service with you. If someone put their faith in Jesus, I want to invite you to see it as a journey and send us an email to info@victoryanaheim.org. Let us know. I put my faith in Jesus today so we can get behind you in your faith journey. The Lord is good. Church of the family of God, I just want to invite you to sing this last song as the team leads us. And I want to say to you, as you go this week, go with God in all you do. Everything you do, take the Lord into it with you. Shine His love into your workplace and into your school and your family, your neighborhood, in everything you do. Shine God's love. You are the people of God. You're destined for greatness in His name. Be great in God's name. Go with God and sing with us right now.
Stretched arms, His love endures forever.
trust him. Amen.